first, I want to greet the artists that are here. We have starting left to right, to my right, we have Maurice Taylor, who's going to do some poetry reading for you. Ed? I call him Ed K, whose work is to my left. We have Misha Epstein, whose work is on the left-hand wall in the back. Misha, raise your hand. And we have Kyle O'Neill. Kai? And her work is in the back, Kyle has Down syndrome. Missing is Bob Daniels, a Vietnam veteran who's a double amputee. He had a problem with getting a ride from PVTA. So that's just a challenge in itself. How we just take things for granted, being able to move around or to do the things that we need. So this is our tribute. Maurice is going to, and we want to thank our musician here.
Thank you.
Maurice is going to read some poetry. I invite you to enjoy the food, the refreshment, talk to the artist, buy some art, and thank you again for coming. Oh, how could I forget Mr. James Kitchen, the sculptor? And James is how I got to meet Ed. James did a piece for Starbucks, which is an organization that builds ramps, and it does other things, but it's popular for its ramps. And I invite you to go see James' piece in the center courtyard of Tower Square. And through that, I met Ed, and my heart just went out. So again, thank you for coming. Ask questions, have fun.
I'm Lois Brown, and I am the director of the Home Sweet Home wheelchair ramp program at Stavros.
Okay. And have you been involved with artwork?
Well, yes. I'm from a family of artists myself, and so I've always had an appreciation for artwork. And when I got a request for a wheelchair ramp for Ed, and I went to meet him, and I saw the work he did. It's like, oh, this has to be seen. This needs to get out there. And was particularly moved by a piece where a painting, oil painting that he did of playing chess, which he's very good at playing chess, with his foot. So you see his foot holding a chess piece, pack of cigarettes, and then another hand, you know, playing chess with his piece. So you know, we got to have that. So, and Ed had so much painting, so many, he offered to help us do a fundraiser, and we raised, I think it was close to $4,000 of just Ed's works selling at an art auction to raise money to help build more wheelchair ramps.
Outstanding.
Which was fabulous, and just people see his work and connect right away.
No one knew about him until these two people came around.
And your name is?
Well, hi, my name is Ani Rivera, and I've known Ed for about over 4 years, I think, since I met Lois, who introduced me to one of his paintings. She brought it to me for scanning and photography for a benefit. And when I saw the painting, I was so blown away. I said, I gotta meet this guy.
All right.
When I heard that he painted it with his foot, I said, I really have to meet this guy.
No kidding.
So I've been an artist my whole life, and I've also worked in the museum world for a big part of my career. I was a collections manager at the Guggenheim Museum. For 10 years, I worked there dealing with major works of art, and so I got a great education in art history from handling and working directly with major collections. But I've been in the field for about over 25 years, as you say, a lot more than that. But when I see art like Ed's, you see that it comes from the heart. And I think that's what makes his work stand out.
Absolutely.
There's no, it's almost as though the work is speaking to us how he is interpreting the world through his work, through his artwork. And it's a wonderful way for us to witness how he sees the world and interprets it, because nobody else could do work like this.
No.
So that's why I got involved, and I'm happy to always help him out.
Okay.
Doing anything we could to help.
Now, you have a studio you opened up in the Amherst Way, and I understand that you guys are now cataloging all of his artwork, or in the process, if you will.
In the process. We've documented over 390 of his originals with photography and scanning, and we've given them all accession numbers, so we have a number that corresponds with each piece in case we have to refer to a work, or in case somebody orders a G-Play print, we know which image it is. So that's probably the tip of the iceberg. There are probably thousands more
that have not
even been discovered yet.
Wow. Well, tell me this. What could you do with his artwork? Would you sell it as a one in a lifetime piece, or we develop prints, or is that yet to be determined?
Ideally, it would be nice if a museum acquired the entire collection as one piece by one artist, and rather than see it split up. But that's a hard thing. That's a hard call, because museums, one, might not have the space for an entire collection, and two, they might not have the funds to properly care for a major collection. But it's rare when you have the work of one artist still intact in one place.
Yeah,
usually, if they get well known, it's already spread out and in different institutions, different places. But this is an opportunity for the entire collection to go to one place. So that would be quite a special thing if that were to happen. But I can see why some collectors might want to aspect certain parts of the collection versus others. So it's quite a variety of pieces in the collection, and we haven't even seen them all.
Now, how would someone be able to get in touch with you guys?
Well, if people buy his work or buy prints of his work, that will help build more wheelchair ramps, which just helps him get in and out of his house, basically. And that's the same for anyone who suddenly needs a ramp. No insurance pays for a ramp, and suddenly a big ticket item. So my program helps people get ramps affordably. Through collaborations with other agencies and grants and fundraisers and stuff. So,
is there any way that
it is basically paying it forward with his work, and what a wonderful way to do it.
It
doesn't get better than that.
Is there anywhere online or somewhere where someone can find out more about Ed or artwork, or even yourself in terms of...
I actually created a small site for him on the Pioneer Valley. He has a site called Valley Art Share.
Okay.
And if you go to Valley Art Share and type in Ed K or EK, Ed's works will come up that we photographed today. A selection of them, not all of them.
Sure.
But they could get a taste of what we have in terms of images that they might be interested in buying or purchasing a G-Clay printer. We're trying to keep the collection intact, so the originals are not being sold right now. But G-Clays, which are 99% close to the original, can be purchased in different sizes, like the ones we have in the gallery.
Okay.
All duplicates. They're not the originals.
Well, since you're so involved with this whole process now of Ed's work, do you have time to do much of your own anymore?
That's a good question. I have not had a lot of time to do my own work, because when you're an artist and you're also in business, you have you need mental space to do creative work.
Sure.
And that's been the power of Ed, in that he's had the mental space his whole life to do creative work, because he's been unable to actually have a job or do something in society, say, for a living, work for a living. So his work is his art, and if I had that kind of mental space, I'd be doing art also.
I hear you. Well, you guys are doing wonderful work, and
thank you.
I know that Ed is very appreciative of everybody that's been a part of his world now, and certainly now I feel connected.
I feel honored to have met him and work with him.
Okay.
To help him.
Yep. He's a real gift to the world.
And first of all, your name is Kyle? Kyle O'Neill. All right. Tell me a little bit about your artwork.
I love my artwork. It's nice and pretty. And I was doing one because I was starting. I was 14.
Okay.
And, I go to school at Jingle Center in West Hartford. And the other one I go to school in Meriden, Pratt. So I'm looking forward to seeing my pistols and be right here.
Uh-huh.
And I was 14, and I was creating my. I used my colors, and I was using textures. I used black, purple, yellow, maybe red.
Okay. And can you tell me what was the first thing you painted?
What?
Do you remember the first thing that you ever painted?
Out of them. I'll tell you.
The very first one.
That was 2008.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Wow.
And the second one is the same thing. It's 2008.
Okay.
And I went to my dad's school, and I was doing ink.
Mm-hmm.
And I think I was having brown, purple,
uh-huh.
and green, and black and yellow.
Okay.
And I'm looking forward to it.
So how has your experience been today? How did you enjoy today being here at the art gallery?
Yes. I'm lucky to see people around me, like seeing me.
They're enjoying filming you.
That's right. Well, Kyle, it's very nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
And I wish you the best of luck in your future and your career as an artist.
These are from a recent show called Transitions.
Okay.
And the name of this series of work is Tribal Threads.
Okay.
And it's representative of our past, Native American blood and also African American blood. So that's how we tried to incorporate that.
Okay.
So that's how this all came about.
Okay.
And I wanted to do work that was complementary to my daughter's work, and she was doing weaving, and I thought of threads.
Gotcha.
And just a different approach.
Okay. Now, what type of material are you use?
I always work in clay.
Oh.
Yeah, so this is all clay.
Really?
Yeah.
What gives it that shininess?
Well, that's a glaze. And what's happened here is a glaze has been applied and then rubbed off.
Okay.
And where the texture is, the more of the glaze stays within that.
Okay.
Down here, down below, these are a carved series.
Oh, okay. When you say carved series, you actually...
So I actually used tools to carve them.
Is that right?
Right.
Now, then
I used different tools to do what's called chattering. And so as the wheel is going around,
yes.
I use a tool that kind of vibrates and then creates a design.
Hmm.
And picks out certain little pieces as the wheel's turning around.
Okay. Now, not only are you a potterer and sculptor, you're also an instructor.
Yeah, I also teach art in the Meriden Public Schools Middle School.
Okay.
And I also teach at Wesleyan Potters, which is an older craft center in Middletown, Connecticut.
Okay. Now, how did you get into this?
I got into clay because my oldest brother was working on Pottery Maravich, and I was fascinated by what he was doing.
Okay.
And then that led me into working in clay.
What is the most difficult thing about working with clay?
Well, there's no promises. You can think it can come out one way when you put it in the kiln, but
okay.
It's always a surprise when it comes out.
Okay.
You can have an idea, but you never know exactly what you're going to get.
Now, the coloration is
now, I use a lot of cobalt. You can notice in the bluer pieces, that's a lot of cobalt. I use cobalt oxide. And then in some of the pieces, I use magnesium. So it's also knowing chemistry and knowing how chemicals will react to the clay. Oh.
Did you mount them yourself?
Now these are slabs. So these are slabs, and these are thrown pieces on the wheel.
Oh.
Okay, so this was a slab, and then what I've done is I put it on a frame, a wooden frame. But these are all different materials. You can see a meat tenderizer. You can see a fine-tooth comb. You can see the end of a magic marker top, one circle after another circle. You can see, you know, a pencil. So you can see all different things. And this has my great-grandmother's butter paddle on it. So I use the corner of the butter paddle to get that texture.
And was was that your intent? Is that you say? Okay,
I wanted to get part of doing what's called tribal threads was to incorporate my past.
Okay.
And I used some earrings that my great grandmother used that had a texture in it. And I rolled it across the clay. So I wanted them to come with me on the journey.
Your name again is?
Gary O'Neill.
Gary O'Neill, yes, sir. Hey, Gary, I really appreciate it, man. Take the time out to explain this to us. This is definitely unique. How can someone find out more about you or your artwork?
Usually, you can find me through Wesleyan Potters in Middletown, Connecticut. They know where I am all the time.
Right now, I'm going to Westport State University, majoring in computer information systems. And before that, I used to work at Human Resources Unlimited at the Farmhouse in Westfield. It's a clubhouse for people with mental illness. And my boss used to always say to me, be gentle, you know? And it took me a while to understand what they were saying. Like, sometimes you gotta take care of people like you have on kids' gloves. And I'm like, what the heck you mean by that, you know what I mean? And so over time, I understood what they were saying, and it works a lot better when you're more gentle with people than you are, you know, stern. So I wrote this poem called Be Gentle. Many like to see us as the boogie monster, violent, wreaking havoc across town. Truth is, many of us share love as we move around. Our history has been as horrific as its diversity, and just as full of fights as our victories. We go to school, we drive, we grow up and learn to survive. Some of us are born to it, others initiated later in life. For many, our innocence and families ripped away, fueling foster care. And no matter how loud we scream, seems like nobody cared. So before you judge the being whose drool stretches down to their lap, be gentle. They may be over-medicated, under-advocated, and just as you, they hate it. We love the wind, the sun, the rain. Some of us feel the sun rays dancing on our bodies and hear the rhythm of the rain. Some of us feel the spit from those who are insane. Some kill us, many ignore us, some never see us. We're not all so evident, we camouflage. Afraid of the ridicule, yet we fix your cars, run your nations. Make sure your blood runs through your veins. And some of us write poetry to help ease your pain, so be gentle. And so for my last one, well, it all depends on whether or not you all are an interactive crowd. So I guess I should ask you, are you an interactive crowd? I said no, come on. All right, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to go around the crowd and get words from the crowd, and from those words I'm going to create a poem. It's kind of challenging, right? So, who would like to help?
Hollywood.
Give me a word. Give me a word, Ed.
Help.
Help. All right.
Healthy coffee.
Healthy coffee? You
can swing it to it.
Yeah, it is too. That's an illegal compound one.
Happy?
Magnificent?
Mysterious.
All right. With 35 letters in it. Anybody, hold on. Did you ever get one?
Yes.
All right. Anybody else?
Misty.
What's your word?
Mysteriousness.
How about chaos? Chaos.
What was your word again?
Misty.
You said chaos. Who else?
Complex.
Values.
All right. So that's 9 words.
Liberating.
Values can be liberating, although complex.
Challenging.
All right, one more.
Right here.
Resilience. Did you ever get a word?
No.
What word?
Resilience.
Yeah.
All right. Well, so
So, the words you gave me are help, healthy coffee, happy, magnificent, misty, mysteriousness, chaos, complex, value, liberating, challenging, and resilience. Sometimes I can make it more challenging to have someone give me a thing. But I don't think I'm going to do that today because I know someone in the crowd is going to, you know, be all sly and give me a 17-letter word. I don't even know. But, you know, I'll try it out. Who wants to give me a theme? Who wants to give me a theme of what the poem would be about?
Art. Creativity. Art.
So who's up for art? Raise your hand. All those for creativity, raise your hand. Oh man, that looks like a tie. So you know what we do? We do it by loudness. So whoever wants art, say art.
Art.
And creativity may win if they can, like, you know, let some air out. Who wants creativity? Say creativity.
Creativity!
Oh, wow, man, they got it. What? Hey, you know what? You're a little bit older than me, and someone told you a long time ago, speak up. If you don't speak up, you won't be heard, right? All right, so, y'all feeling jazzy?
Yeah.
Creativity. For many people to exist in this world, it takes creativity. See, when you step out the door and you feel the tension in the air. Having that place to escape to in your mind is a liberating feeling. To be able to hope that our society will be happy someday comes from engaging in actions that are challenging, such as voting for the first female senator or maybe the first black governor, but even harder than that, bending the mind to think that it can happen for educating a society, giving them values like love, but before then, this misty ignorance created a veil over many eyes in society, and it caused others to look down on others, but others decided to stand and help. Just the mysteriousness of it all is trying to put a finger on what drives those who stand, those who gain nothing but freedom for the sacrifice. Takes resilience. Resilience is being knocked down and getting back up, being knocked down and getting back up, being knocked down and getting back up, being knocked back and moving forward again, being knocked back and knocked down and getting back up and moving forward again. It's really not all that complex. I mean, it is like a game of chess, but once you know how to move and once you know how they move, you really do get in the groove. And this race to freedom, it looks long in the beginning, but you do see the light. And in fact, you become the light. That creativity allows that light to shine through all of us. Whether it's through a sculpture that was brought over to model the Statue of Liberty after, or maybe it's a painting that showed Michael Schwerner on the ground from others with the right to vote, or maybe it's just words that ask you, no, words that beg you to be gentle, because we never know where someone else is coming from, but to be gentle because we don't know where we're going, but to be gentle because once we stop being gentle, love stops flowing. Like healthy coffee. So the words you gave me was help, healthy coffee, happy, magnificent, misty, mysteriousness, chaos, complex, value, liberating, challenging, and resilience. Thank you very much.
I want to thank you for attending Challenges, a tribute to artists with disabilities. Tonight we had Ed Kawasaki, who paints with his feet, Misha Epstein, who has epilepsy, we had Kyle O'Neill from Down syndrome, and absent in body but present in spirit, Bob Daniels, who's a double amputee. On behalf of Artist Green Room Gallery, we would like to thank you. We'd like to thank our musician, my assistant, Gene Scales, and to all of the Springfield community. Thank you.
honeysuckle and a great big expression of happiness. Boy, you couldn't miss with a dozen roses. Such would astound you, the joy of children laughing around you. These are the makings of you. It is true, the makings of you. The righteous way to go, little one would know or believe if I told them so. You're second to none, the love of all mankind should reflect some sign of these words I've tried to recite. They are close but not quite, almost impossible to do, reciting the makings of you. Righteous way to go, little one would know or believe if I told them so. You're second to none, the love of all mankind should reflect some sign of these words I've tried to recite. They are close but not quite, almost impossible to do, reciting the makings of you.